Hi folks, well we're back for another week in our study on the book of Amos, and this week we're in chapter 4. And we'll just commence reading it and do a little deciphering along the way, things that we should remember. It's good to bring to light the little things, little nuances in conversation, you might say, that the prophet gives, that teaches us things that are important in other parts of the Bible. Hear this word, you cows of Bashan on Mount Samaria, you women who oppress the poor and crush the needy and say to your husbands, bring us more drinks. You notice here he's calling the women of Samaria. Go back in the study, find out what Samaria represents. The women of Samaria he calls the cows of Bashan. There's a place in scripture, I'll put it here, where, who was it now? Samson? I can't recall exactly. I think it was Samson. And he tells a riddle to some men, and they can't figure out the riddle, so they threatened his bride-to-be to explain the riddle to them or they'd kill her and her family. So she coerces Samson to tell her the answer to the riddle. She goes back and tells these men, and these men answer the riddle correctly. And Samson says something interesting. He says, you wouldn't know the answer if you hadn't plowed with my heifer. A heifer is a young female cow. Is he making a similar distinction in calling the women of Samaria cows when he called his bride-to-be a cow? There's lots there to eat if you want to go and look it up and read about it. Consider things like, well, where was this young woman from? What nation did she belong to? Where did her dad come from? Because Samson is obviously calling her a cow, although he uses the word heifer, a very young cow. Bashan, what is Bashan? The sovereign Lord has sworn by his holiness, the time will come when you will be taken away with hooks, the last of you with fish hooks. You will each go straight out through breaks in the wall, and you will be cast out towards Harmon. Well, what is Harmon, you know? In my 84 edition of the NIV, it has a footnote on Harmon, and it says that in the Masoretic text, with a different word division of the Hebrew, see the Septuagint, out, O mountain of oppression. Interesting. I think they both say the same thing. Go to Bethel and sin. What is Bethel? We've mentioned these things. Go to Gilgal and sin yet more. What's Gilgal? All you have to do is punch in the word, go to your favorite Bible translation on the internet. Go try Bible Online or something like that. It has all the translations. And punch in the word Gilgal. And read everything it says about Gilgal. Listen to the context of how this word is being used, and you'll find a spiritual definition. It's not a place on a map. It's a place in the mind and heart. Bring your sacrifices every morning. your tithes every 3 years. It's hard not to stop. Notice the tithes every 3 years. If you go back into Deuteronomy and you read about the tithing, you're going to learn something. I'm going to put two scriptures here. Read those scriptures. You'll learn something very interesting about tithing. Very interesting. And the 3 years is applicable. The 3 years is applicable to the correct definition of tithing and how it's to be done. Burn leavened bread as a thank offering and brag about your freewill offerings. Boast about them, you Israelites, for this is what you love to do, declares the Sovereign Lord. Remember what Israel is? Remember the very part one of this study? The Israel of God? It's us. I gave you empty stomachs in every city and lack of bread in every town. That's interesting, eh? In other words, God withheld the mysteries I'm trying to show you. Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord. So he didn't just plop it all down on the table like some think he does, did he? He expects us to do a little bit of the work. Remember, I've told you in the past how God looks at the mind, he listens to what our thoughts are, and he knows what our desires are. And only when he sees sincerity of mind and heart does he feed us. So if he doesn't see that sincerity, how does it say somewhere else? I'll put it here. Concerning, we have whatever we ask for. And people seem to think that it's, we already have it. Well, yeah, we do have it. It's right here. But if you don't go looking, you'll never find it. And it explains about how sincerity is so important if you want what you ask for. You have to ask for the right reasons. I also withheld rain. Remember, rain is understanding. I also withheld rain from you when the harvest was still 3 months away. Your harvest is going to be very, very affected by a lack of rain during the growing season, isn't it? In the same way, your understanding is going to be very, very affected. Your reward at the harvest is going to be very affected by your understanding, by the rain that you've received. I sent rain on one town, but withheld it from another. One field had rain, another had none and dried up. People staggered from town to town for water, but did not get enough to drink. Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord. They're not very sincere, are they? They don't really give a fiddling fart. Many times I struck your gardens and vineyards. Remember what the garden and the vineyards are? I struck them with blight and mildew. Locusts. Remember what locusts are? False ideas. A.K.A. demons? Locusts devoured your fig and olive trees. Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord. What does the fig tree and the olive tree represent in Scripture? Again, you know how to find out. I sent plagues among you, as I did in Egypt. Excuse me. I sent plagues among you, as I did to Egypt. I killed your young men with the sword. Along with your captured horses. Remember the sword. Don't think of the Lord swinging some metal sword, killing people in war or something, you know what I mean? Physical, man-made war. Think of the sword as the Word of God. Think of horses as that which carries you from point A to point B, from this understanding to that understanding. I filled your nostrils with the stench of your camps, yet you have not returned to me. I filled your nostrils with the stench of your camps. I'll tell you, the camps stink. That's all I can say. They don't smell good. I click on YouTube. I see all these videos from people. Some of them think they're prophets. Some of them think they're great men of God. Others think they... Many think they are God. It just stinks. It's a stench. And yet, they don't care. They're having fun. They got their religion, don't they? I overthrew some of you, as I overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah is something that everyone should really look into and find out how God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. And if you read it all in every book that describes it, found in the Bible, you come away with a completely different understanding of how God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. It was no nuclear attack. Of that I assure you. You were like a burning stick snatched from the fire. Yet you have not returned to me. You ever take a stick out of a fire? It still has a bit of flame on it. A little smoke. But it's so charred, it's worthless. Therefore, this is what I will do to you, Israel. And because I will do this to you, prepare to meet your God. He who forms the mountains. Remember what mountains are? Governments. Creates the wind and reveals his thoughts to man. Oh, God reveals his thoughts to us. I wonder how he does that. He who turns dawn to darkness. Dawn is when you start to see the light. Remember the cartoon with the little guy and the light bulb comes on in his head? Dawn is when you see the light, and darkness is ignorance. Dawn is when you begin to understand, and darkness is no understanding. He who turns dawn to darkness and treads the high places of the earth. The Lord God Almighty is his name. And that's the end of chapter 4. Should be enough. Lots of work there. Lots of things to look up. To investigate. 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 It's important. Anyways, that's it for this week. I love you all. Don't forget, Jesus is Lord. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. If you love God, you'll understand the identity of the Christ and who, how, where, what, why, and when the Christ appeared. And you'll acknowledge his name. And he'll have shown you how to love. Because believe me, we haven't got a clue how to love. Until God, whose spirit is love, enters into us and shows us. Bye for this week. God bless.